Dr. Aubrey De Grey is joining us. He's a biomedical gerontologist and also the chief science officer at the SENS Foundation, joining us today from California. Dr. De Grey, it's great to speak with you again. You know, after the last time you were on the show talking about potential new therapies, cell therapies, which could indefinitely extend one's life, we had so much feedback that I figured we should have you back and talk about what the reaction was. And, you know, one of the most interesting themes I saw in people's reaction to your interview was a lot of objections to what you're proposing that may be possible based on religion. And my question to you was twofold. Number one, do you run into that a lot in your work? And number two, I was thinking, weren't there 900-year-olds in the Bible? I mean, it doesn't seem like it's that disconnected.
Well, I don't really like to talk too much about whether the reported longevity in the Bible has any real relevance to what we do, because, of course, there are many interpretations of that. But the actual, the compatibility between religious belief, whether it's Christian or otherwise, and the work that we do is actually very clear. In fact, we can go further than that. It's not just that efforts to defeat aging are compatible with Scripture. They are actually mandated by Scripture. Because, let's face it, aging causes suffering. It causes a lot of suffering. And Scripture is very unequivocal on the point that we are supposed to do our very best to minimize suffering. Now, some people may say, well, yeah, that's all very well, but there's this problem of this side effect of this work, namely that people will live a great deal longer. But here again, that's really an inappropriate way to look at it, because, as I just said, the longevity benefits that we may expect from this are simply a side benefit, something that we can anticipate as a natural consequence of keeping people healthy and keeping their quality of life high. And, of course, that side effect is not absolutely certain. Last I heard, God was supposed to be omnipotent, which means that God can strike us down with a thunderbolt, however healthy we are, whatever age he chooses. So there's no sense in which this is in any way disrupting or challenging God's plan for the world, just the opposite. Another way of putting this is to point out that all of medicine is about improving people's health and thereby increasing their longevity. And I don't hear many people condemning natural medicine of today from a religious perspective. There's no difference.
Interesting. Let me give you a couple of other questions that we got. Rebecca wrote in and she said, I think anti-aging will become like cancer therapies. There are many types of aging, just as there are many types of cancer, and each will need a separate approach. Does Dr. De Grey agree with that, or is he really researching a one-shot solution?
Let me answer that question in reverse order. The approach that we're taking is certainly not a one-shot solution in the sense of being a treatment that would be administered just once, and then one would become non-aging in some way until one was in some way reinfected. That's not going to happen. Aging is an intrinsic phenomenon in the body, which is going to carry on happening and which can be prevented from leading to ill health only by periodic treatments that essentially reverse the biological clock, repair the damage of aging every so often, so that it doesn't become abundant enough to cause diseases and disabilities. Now, to move on to the core of the question, the SENS approach is very much a divide and conquer approach. We divide the problem of aging into seven major sub-problems, and we attack each of those sub-problems with a particular solution. But to answer the business about essentially whether this needs to be personalized, actually, the beauty of the SENS approach is that it should be applicable pretty much without modification to everybody, irrespective of which aspects of aging happen to be going a little bit faster or a little bit more slowly in one person relative to another person. And actually, the analogy with cancer is a very appropriate one here, because cancer is indeed not just one disease. There are an enormous number of different types of cancer, each with their own peculiarities. And the treatments that we see today in cancer have to actually take that into account. Most treatments, in fact, pretty much all treatments that we have today for cancer are very much focused on individual cancer types. However, the SENS approach to combating cancer is truly universal because it addresses, it attacks one thing that cancers do all have in common, however much they don't have in common, namely the need to extend the ends of the chromosomes, the telomeres, in order to achieve indefinite cell division.
Okay. One thing we touched on a little bit, and you alluded to this by saying, if this type of life extension does become commonplace, something like driving would realistically be outlawed because it would be far too risky. I got an email saying, I think near immortality would bring radical changes to human behavior. People would be extremely careful. They would take no risks. Fear of death is a lot higher if you have the possibility of living 1,000 years than when you could only live 80 to 90 years. What do you think of that? I tend to think you agree.
Well, yes and no. So my prediction that driving would be outlawed was actually something that I wrote way, way back in 1998 or 99, when I had just very first started thinking about all of this, and SENS itself actually had not even been formulated. And I now think that that's actually quite unlikely to happen. I think that, yes, we will become very much more risk-averse, very much more interested in avoiding causes of death that today we are relatively blasé about because they are already relatively rare in the short number of years that we have available to us. But that the way that we will actually implement that risk aversion is not, in general, going to be by avoiding the activities that are risky, but rather by making those activities less risky through technology. So in the case of driving, I think it's extremely likely that all we will do is make driving a lot safer by making much more much safer cars with a lot of automatic fail-safes and overrides to accommodate human error. This is the sort of technology that is perfectly within reach today. It's just that it's extremely expensive because the only people who think that it actually is value for money are the military, more or less. If that's no longer true, if there's a mass market for such things, then of course the sophistication will increase and the price will decrease.
Well, can we, is there evidence that as life expectancy has increased already, over the last couple of hundred years, people have already become more risk averse? I mean, I was thinking if a 20-year-old thinks that they're going to live 160 years instead of 80, I can't imagine they would really act too differently. So there has to be, it has to be a sliding scale to a certain degree.
I think you're right. It is a sliding scale. And I think that in particular, we should not talk about the attitudes to risk that people under the age of, let's say, 20 or 25 have.
Because okay.
People probably haven't really quite got a good sense of how to evaluate risk in the first place. But if we talk about people who are a little bit further through life, I think that there may not be so much of a sliding scale. I think there may be a lot of risk. Then again, I think the point you make about the possibility that we've already seen an increase in risk aversion can actually be supported by data. One thing that one can look at is the, let's say, the attitude to the value of life that is shown by the actions of people across the world in different societies. The one example that I like to point to, because it's very, very conspicuous, is the situation with AIDS in South Africa, where, of course, the head of state of South Africa for many, many years was taking a public position, and indeed a policy position, based on the idea that HIV doesn't cause AIDS. Now, if the head of state of anywhere in the industrialized world, in the Western world, had said the same thing, they wouldn't have been the head of state for very long. So I think we can say that, bearing in mind, let's face it, South Africa is a democracy, that this really is a rather clear expression that people in South Africa just didn't have the same intensity in terms of wanting something to be done about AIDS that exists elsewhere. And I think it is reasonable to suppose that a large part of that comes from the fact that there's such a high risk of mortality from other causes in sub-Saharan Africa in general, even in South Africa, relative to what we see in the West.
Interesting. I wish we had more time. My last thought on this is, let's say you're right about the development of this technology in the relatively near future. Do we really want Rick Santorum living 1,000 years? That's, I think, the real question we have to eventually get to.
Whether Rick Santorum wants Rick Santorum to live 1,000 years. I mean, we won't be tying people down and rejuvenating them by force, you see.
That's good, but it's probably good for him to know that. Dr. Aubrey De Grey, biomedical gerontologist, also chief science officer at the SENS Foundation. Great to speak with you as always.
My pleasure.